Hello, podcast listeners. You are now listening to the Coffee, Health, and Science podcast. I'm your host, Jordan River, and I want to thank you for tuning in yet again today. Before we get started, as always, I urge you to share the show, spread the Coffee, Health, and Science podcast, hit that subscribe button so you catch every single episode, and give us a good rating and review if you would. It really helps out the show. Today, we are talking about one of my favorite topics to discuss here on the show. We're talking about fasting, we're talking about diet and nutrition, and so much more. Our guest today is Dr. William Hsu. How's it going, my friend?
Hi, Jordan. Thank you for having me on your podcast.
Yes, welcome to the Coffee, Health, and Science podcast. Now, right off the bat, Dr. Hsu's website, l-nutra.com, you can go here and there's a lot of education on the site and more info to bring you into everything that he does. But just from a 30,000-foot view, Dr. Hsu, I know you are a longevity specialist. I know you are a fasting specialist, disease prevention specialist. Talk to us about yourself, about your background, and what your mission is with L Nutra.
Yeah. So I am an endocrinologist. So I'm a physician that specializes in the human condition that relates to hormones, and especially in the area of obesity and diabetes. And so I have been I've been teaching at medical school and conducting research and seeing patients for over 20 years. And about 2 years ago, I joined L Nutra as the chief medical officer. So here I'm helping the company, really taking what we've discovered in the laboratories at University of Southern California and translate that into human evidence so that we could share all the benefits of fasting with more people, with stronger evidence, and really try to take our science into mainstream medicine.
Wow, that is so fascinating and perfect for a show like this. I think the audience is really going to dig into it. We can get to, in a minute, how to implement fasting safely and some really great tips, but I kind of want to drill down first on something you just said there, taking what we learn in the laboratory and then applying it out into the real world. What are some examples, some specific examples of just that, things that you've kind of hypothesized and then found and verified in the lab and then seen people actually enact in their own lives?
Yeah, this is really such a timely discussion. You know, we as Americans now are embracing intermittent fasting really as one of the most popular diets. But the root for intermittent fasting really didn't start recently. It really had been part of our lifestyle for hundreds and thousands, if not millions of years.
Right.
And it's the evidence that from what we see in nature, not only in humans, but also in animals, and that we're seeing the same things happening in humans. For example, the intersection between fasting, between nutrition and as well as longevity, that intersection is what we saw in the laboratory. Mm. And how fascinating it would be if we can take what we learn in animals and prove it in humans that fasting is indeed good for our health and can support our healthy longevity lifestyle.
Wow. So is it about, we know the standard American diet, SAD, as it's abbreviated, we know that's not great. But is it also about, like you're saying, kind of not just the quality of what we're consuming, but the quantity and the timing of what we're consuming?
Wow, that's a really insightful question. For a long time we debated, right? Every other day we see a fad diet comes and goes, right? I don't want to name them. You could probably list the list is probably longer than we can. We have the time to talk about it. Every couple of years, there seems to be a shift, right? And yet, for a long time, the discussion had always been, what should I eat? But I think until recently, the science has begun looking at diet in a totally different way. Instead of asking, like, what can I eat, which is still important, the question is asking, when should I eat?
Wow.
And that introduces a paradigm shift in thinking about, hey, it's not only about what we put in your mouth, but the timing of when you put the food in your mouth has a serious impact on the health outcomes.
Again, before we get into the specifics, why do you think that is? is it about, you know, never, I've heard it explained to me in layman's terms before, right? Basically never giving your digestion a chance to stop actively working, never giving your body a chance to stop diverting energy resources towards the digestive process, and instead allowing things like anti-inflammation processes and immune system responses to kind of take over, which sounds very, again, like layperson, like taking energy from here to there. But I know that, you know, you talk about ATP and things like this. There is literally limited energy. But what is it about the timing of our eating that affects the health over and overall wellness so much?
Yeah, I think it really has to do with the nature's design. Think about in the old days before the invention of electricity or light bulbs, before the days of Edison, we typically would start eating when the sun rises and we stop eating when the sun sets.
Right.
And in fact, I mean, that's because we're not nocturnal animals, right? So that's actually built into our body system. If you look at some of the fabulous work done through researchers that actually won them the Nobel Prize in 2017, every body's cells, in fact, every cell in our body has an internal clock in there. So that means your gut has an internal clock, you know, your pancreas, your liver, they all have an internal clock. And the internal clock is synced to the master clock of the body, which is the, sort of the brain, right? Sort of the gland, the central clock in the brain. And that central clock is synced to the rising of the sun, the setting of the sun. So by asking the question when we should eat, we should be eating, is really just really syncing up what the nature's design is. We're supposed to eat when the sun comes up, and we're supposed to stop eating when the sun goes down. And when you go counter against that, when you eat in a pattern that's against it, then you're putting stress on the body, which then turns into many bad things for our health.
Geez, so it is just about ancestry at this point. The way that humans have evolved has created a system where this is how it works. And like you said, going against it. And I can vouch for that. You know, the crappy nights sleep you get from eating junk food right before bed, the disruption of the sleep cycle and the ruining of that anti-inflammation and process and so much more. Very interesting. Can we talk about implementing fasting? You know, I think that a lot of people get daunted when they see these hardcore fasts, or someone's like, you know, I'm going to do a lemon juice cleanse for a month. I think that with intermittent fasting, where you kind of extend the hours on either side of your day, I think it's much more approachable and applicable than some of these more hardcore fasts. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. So there are two different kinds of fasts, which really they're different in quantity as well as in its desired effect. So the intermittent fasting is what you just mentioned, right? Most of the common intermittent fasting is called time-restricted eating. I mean, that's a long, it's a sort of a very scientific name, but what it really means is just like limit the number of hours you eat in a day to a certain number of hours.
Sure.
Okay, for example, a lot of people say 16-8. What does that mean? It means 16 hours of not eating and limit all of the eating to the 8 hours.
And
the beauty about that kind of approach of the 8 hours eating is that you don't really have to pay a lot of attention to what you're eating, but rather just limit the number of hours you're eating. So eat everything that you typically would consume within the 8 hour window. And so that is really, it brings up the convenience factor. You don't have to count calories. You don't have to count specific food. You simply have to watch your clock. And that's really been quite popular. In fact, there's a survey that says that now 10% of Americans are practicing some sort of intermittent fasting.
Wow.
And by that, that really means about 30 million people, if you will.
That's actually pretty incredible. And really, it speaks volumes to doctors like you coming on shows like mine. You know what I mean? Like that's where people hear about this and then they try it. and it really works. It makes them feel much better. It has tangible results that a lot of the times their primary care physician, the stuff they recommend, doesn't have the same tangible. You know what I mean? If you put you on some pills or something, but you don't want to be on pills, you try something like this, you're seeing results instantly. You're feeling better. You're feeling stronger. You're sleeping better. I think that's why that number is growing. And to be honest, that's kind of surprisingly high. That's great to hear that 30 million Americans are not only aware of the benefits, but actually implementing it.
Yeah, it's actually not surprising because we know diet fails, right? You could try to be good on a day or a week for a month, but how do you make it last for, making a lifestyle? It's so difficult. And especially if you are trying to lose weight on a diet, that means you're always reducing your calories and it's going to backfire someday because you just get tired or that your body's metabolism is going to slow down to try to preserve, right, the balance of energy, and then it becomes counterproductive. We all know that. I think if you don't believe it, just wait until January of next year. After your New Year resolution, you're going to say, he's right. It's not working. So fasting, on the other hand, can be implemented so easily into everyday lifestyle. So I think that's one of the reasons why it's so popular.
Right. And as a doctor, usually you got to be so concerned about, telling people you got to do this right. You got to be careful. It sounds like the intermittent fasting is rather benign, rather safe. Just start to shave off those hours on either side of the day, right? This isn't really something that is super dangerous to recommend to people, or correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, it's safer than, let's say, being on a water fast for 3 days or 5 days straight. Exactly. Without eating any food. That's clear. But it's interesting because I think the amount of stress that the body experiences through intermittent fasting also varies with the number of hours you're fasting. For example, some people try this one meal a day approach. That's like 24, meaning 20 hours of fasting, 4 hours of eating. Now, that's pretty stressful, right? And if you do this every day, you can imagine the hunger pain, you can imagine the stress on the body is much stronger compared to, let's say, 12-12. So 12-12 is very interesting, right? So 12 hours of eating, 12 hours of not eating is actually probably the most synced up with our the way our body, the nature's design. Yeah, because 12 hours where the sun's up and 12 hours the sun is down. So I think everybody should be doing 12-12. That is like
the baseline.
There should be very little risk to doing 12-12.
Right. Now,
right. But I mean, you might think it's easy, but actually most of us eat beyond 12 hours, if you think about that, right? In the morning and late dinner and then a snack at night.
Of course, yeah.
So if you could do, if we could do 12-12, I think that everybody should be doing at least 12-12. Now, if you have a specific metabolic goals, like you wanted to lose a little bit more weight, you wanted to stabilize some of the metabolic factors in your body, it's been difficult to get on a diet, you really wanted to have that first push or a stronger push, then you might want to increase the number of fasting hours from 12 to 14, let's say, and then to 16, let's say, right? But just remember, it's a trade-off. The more hours you're fasting, sure, it's going to produce the effect, but it's also that continuous stress on the body. So you wanted to balance that.
Sure. That makes a lot of sense. And like you said, the 12-12, I think where people really struggle is the late night snack. That's when food is most delicious. That's when junk food is most delicious. It's scientifically proven. And it's funny. I just spoke with Dr. Joel Wade. He's kind of a self-esteem and happiness expert. Anyways, he was talking about willpower. He was talking about human willpower and how willpower wanes throughout the day. It's just like a muscle. You can exercise it and get it stronger, but it also fatigues like a muscle. And he said that's when you really have to be careful, is at the end of the day when your willpower is low. And man, I see that with the foods, late night hot dog, late night slice of pizza, DoorDash 24/7. It's very, very hard. And I think that's where people often fall off the wagon.
You're absolutely right. And also, if you let's say it's a weekday and you cannot sleep in the next morning, you got to wake up and go to work. I mean, the shorter the number of hours of sleep, the more hunger hormone it's going to trigger. And so throughout the day, the next day, you're going to be even more hungrier. And so it really, it's a vicious cycle.
That is a vicious cycle. Can you talk to us about some of the specific reactions that are going on in our body? I know we only have you for, what do you have, another 10 minutes with us? Is that possible? Or do you have a hard
Sure.
Okay, let's do another 10
minutes. No, we're good.
Talk to us about what's happening to our body as we're stopping the digestion and giving our digestion a break.
Yeah. So I think, you know, a couple of things is that the body, it gets a break, right? So it's really important we accelerate our pace through all these high proteins, high nutrition food. You just think about it, it's almost like a racetrack, right? So if you see this race car going around the circle, right, and doing these laps. Now, somewhere along the way, there is a pit stop. Now, why do you have to have a pit stop? Because you got to change the tires, because the tires are revving so fast. You're grinding away the tread on the wheels. Mm. The body is really meant to do this, right? So, you know, one example would be looking at exercise. I mean, we know exercise is so good for us, but can you exercise 24 hours? No, it'll be terrible for you.
Right.
Right. So same thing with nutrition. It's great to have nutrition, but should we have nutrition all around our waking hours? That's probably not good. Right. It's always that balance. You need to give the cells enough fuel to grow, but also because they're growing so fast. Like if you're adults, like you and me, Jordan, why do we need to grow more? I mean, we ended up growing sideways, right? We ended up growing. I mean, we gain weight. Our belly becomes bigger.
Direction.
Horizontally. That's right. So I think we do need to give the body a little break. Now, if you look at the human fasting in through different cultures and throughout different religions and through different ages, it generally involves a little bit longer than intermittent fast, right? So these people will go into a mountain and they would, you know, go into a monastery or you know, whatever religious or spiritual experience they have, it generally is 2-3 days. Now, you're talking about a very different physiologic impact with those fasting. That is different than intermittent fasting. You know, with those longer period of fasting, your body goes into that rejuvenation mode. It's almost like, hey, there's no income for the next day or so. You're like, okay, you know, I'm just going to wait it out. But if there's no income for the next month, then you're going to say, oh, wow, I got to do something different.
Right.
Now, if for a couple of months you don't have income, you're going to say, I definitely got to change my lifestyle. So that's what the cells are experiencing as they are saying, hey, there's a day no food. Oh, 2 days without food. Oh, 3 days. Well, I gotta start to recycle some of the stuff, the old and worn out cells inside the cells, and replace them with some new ones. So that recycling becomes so fundamental to a lot of the health, deep cellular benefits associated with a longer fast.
Wow.
And in fact, if you look at 2016, Nobel Prize was given to Professor Otsumi, who discovered the pathways related to those longer fasts. And he even coined a term called autophagy. This is autophagy. This is a cell basically engulfing some of the older worn out cells in the body and replacing those components with new ones.
Wow.
Does this sound fantastic? I mean, that's rejuvenation.
Wow.
And that is really the key, is that the alternating cycle between fasting and then you're giving food, and then fasting, you're giving food, that nourishment and fasting, that turns out to be the fundamental mechanism to support healthy aging.
That is so fascinating. And it kind of rings true with what other guests have said. We had a cellular specialist talking about the need to basically what you just said, rejuvenate the cells, push out all the garbage that apparently gets stored. And that's something that can't happen, apparently, when we're working so hard.
No. We call that cellular junk, right? We try to get rid of those cellular junk and replace them with good ones.
That's the scientific term? When you're with your doctor peers, you can call it cellular junk?
That's the term that my patients understand.
Okay, cool. That's hilarious. It does seem rather simple. Like, it's the same thing that I was alluding to earlier that you were just saying. Like, there's a limited amount of... Well, with any organism, right? Truly, it seems that there's a limited amount of energy exchange currency. And if we're spending it all the time revving that digestive engine, as you said, it makes sense that we would experience burnout eventually. So pretty
yeah.
Interesting stuff. I would love to go over, I mean, I don't want to get into the minutia or have you, you know, trudge through, you know, et al. Studies or whatever. But can you talk about some of what we know from like a population standpoint, what happens when we employ this fasting? I don't know, things like disease prevention numbers or if you have any lifespan information to share with us?
Yeah, it's very interesting. So if you look at the blue zone regions of the world, right? So in Italy, in Okinawa, Japan, in other places, if you look at the centenarians, people who live greater than 100 years, and if you look at those communities, intermittent fasting, especially time-restricted eating, is often a part of their lifestyle. That these people, they eat when the sun rises and they stop eating, you know, right before the sunset. You know, obviously they have their the reason for their longevity has got to be multiple factors, right? From community to having purpose in life, to having good genes, right, and eating good food. But it's been observed that intermittent fasting is practiced in many of these centenarian communities. And so that is really encouraging for us on a population level. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you look at some of the religious groups that that practices fasting, it's also, I mean, there was an abstract in maybe about 2 years ago from the American Heart Association showing that people who fast at least once a week, one day a week, they actually have better outcomes, you know, after cardiovascular procedure, a heart procedure. And so I think we're beginning to see on a population level how this can be incorporated into our lifestyle without making a commitment to a lifelong a change in the way we eat. By simply paying attention to the hours we eat, there could be many benefits.
I love that. And I had never thought before, of course, taking a look at different populations who practice different religious diets, that's super fascinating. I really, really like that. I love this idea of coffee and I'm sorry, that was a slip of the tongue. I love this idea of fasting and, implementing these, you know, applicable again, ones changes that you can make in your lifestyle that aren't going to totally break the bank. I will say at the end here, as we wrap it up, you got to incorporate coffee into this, right? I hit the coffee early in the morning. It doesn't seem to break my fast. You were talking about the blue zones. You know, the Okinawans specifically. I went deep on the Okinawans, taking a look at what differentiates them from the rest of Japan, which also has a pretty long lifespan. But the special yams that they eat on the island, as opposed to rice primarily. And another thing, I'm not sure, this is one that gets less play. Okinawans drink more coffee than tea, as opposed to the rest of Japan. That's right. They're coffee drinkers in Okinawa. I know as a hormone specialist, you're probably pretty wary of over-caffeination, because I know that can wreak havoc if someone is sensitive to the caffeine. But what do you think about coffee, and has it kind of crept into your longevity studies yet?
Yes. It's such a pragmatic question. Like, you ask people to fast, and some people, while they're fasting, they get a headache. And, you know, we often call them kind of the keto flu symptoms. And that is because the body is not used to burning fat, your own internal fat, as the source of fuel, right? The body is so used to digesting and using carbohydrate as a fuel. And then the body almost forget how to use the fat, you know, and turn them into ketone. And so often you get these headaches. Right. And so we know, for example, that coffee, when consumed in a large quantity, can actually activate some of the nutrient sensors in the cells. And let me explain. So, you know, every cell has got these ears and eyes that can sense whether there's nutrients coming. Because if there are nutrients if they sense nutrients in the blood, the cells go into a growth mode. Now, if the cells do not sense that the nutrients circulating in the blood, that is going into that protective, that rejuvenation mode. Wow. Now, as we said a little bit earlier, we want the cells to do both, you know, at different times of the day. Sometimes they should be in the growth mode, sometimes they should be in the resting mode, right? Now, coffee in large quantity could activate one of these sensors, what we call the nutrient sensors. And protein kinase A in particular, However, the good news for your listeners, for all the coffee lovers, is that there's a threshold effect, right? As long as you do not exceed probably 130 milligrams of caffeine per day, that's generally a cup of a tall, size latte or coffee, I think you're going to be fine.
Interesting. So that is so fascinating. That just has my head spinning as far as the nutrient sensors and the uptake of those nutrients. I might imagine there's some good studies on coffee and building muscle. But of course, like you said, don't want to be activating this at the wrong time. Super fascinating. And something I did not expect. That was not planned, listeners. That was just a little bonus fact there.
Yeah. The body is so complex, but the beauty is, I think given the many benefits of coffee, drink it in moderation. A cup of coffee, even during your fasting, should be able to keep you in a fasting state without triggering these nutrient sensors in your cells.
I love it. Absolutely love it. This was a pleasure, Dr. Hsu. I really cannot express how nice of a surprise this was. L-Nutra.com. That's L-Nutra.com to find out more. Anywhere else we can send the listeners here before we wrap it up?
Well, I think because fasting is so difficult for most people, we've come up with some specific solutions to help people to combat sort of the hunger feeling without breaking your fast. So we have come up through many 20 years of actually laboratory research, a bar called the Fast Bar. And it's really designed to keep the body in the fasting state while nourishing the body. So this sounds like an oxymoron, right? How do you nourish the body while you're fasting? I think it has all to do with this nutrient sensors. If we're able to provide nutrients in such a way that actually falls below the trigger threshold of these nutrient sensors, we can actually, in fact, feed your body at the same time, keep your body in a fasting state. So if you're interested in finding fasting difficult, especially intermittent fasting, difficult as you're stretching out to the 16 hours and 18 hours hour fast, you might want to check out Fasting Bar or the fastbar.com.
Whoa, fastbar.com. I had no idea that you were involved with this. That is very fast. That's fascinating. Fastbar.com, everybody. Check it out. Get at us with your results. If you're trying intermittent fasting, we'd love to hear about it. And stay tuned for more Coffee Health and Science podcast. One more time, thank you, Dr. Hsu, as a first-time guest. This was wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you for having me on your show.
Of course, anytime, my friend. And thank you, listeners. Stay tuned. As I said, hit subscribe. Gotta hit subscribe. We'll see you next time. This is Jordan River and Dr. William Hsu signing off, saying have an extraordinary day. We'll see you next time on the Coffee Health and Science podcast.